Now, I have to warn you all that this is convention number 6 for the year. And the previous convention, some of you all might be aware of what NPM stands for. Officially, it's National Pastoral Musicians, but since, of course, I work with the Archdiocese and I'm at Blessed Sacrament Cathedral, I was participating in that. And in the spirit of NPM, I wanted to begin with a little bit of congregational participation. How many of you are associated with a church? Okay, this is not a surprise. How many of your churches have bell towers? Okay, how many of you have actual bells in the bell tower? Okay, if you have one bell, raise your hand. If you have two bells, raise your hand. That includes one. Keep your hands raised. Okay, if you have three bells, raise your hands. Four? Five? Ten? How many of you don't know what you have in your tower? Okay, now the point of this little talk today is we are going to crash, and I do mean crash through, we're going to have a little bit of structure here, but I want to crash through the history of why bells are a part of the church. And the most important part of what I want to do is to try and answer any questions you might have about, or confusion you might have about the appropriate way to deal with bells. Believe it or not, they're kind of fragile. And, of course, liturgical law says some very specific things about it. And this is law that is not necessarily followed, practiced, or known. And my job is to orient you all about what to do with your bells if you have them, or how to give people a basic understanding of what role bells have in Western liturgy. All five of the churches you're dealing with here have interesting bells as a part of them. The company that I co-own is a Dutch company. We maintain three of the five towers, and I've been in every single one of the towers looking at the bells. You may not know this, but Detroit is the home of the oldest ringing church bells west of Philadelphia. The oldest bell we have here in this city ringing is a 1743 Bilby bell at St. Charles Borromeo. And also, significantly, one of the most interesting bells, which I can now talk about because we know who's doing the restoration, is a bell that was forgotten about literally for decades, if not longer, at Assumption Church, which appears to be an original 18th century French bell imported by the French missionaries when the parish was established on its current site. This is a very important bell, and during the restoration will probably get a lot of national attention in Canada because it's one of the original relics of the founders of the mission. So I want to just demystify a whole bunch of things. But we're going to start with a little historic overview and then talk about the primary differences amongst bells, basically two categories, ecclesiastical and civic, and how we kind of confuse those things in America these days. And then to talk a little bit about automation, you know, bells ringing automatically. Not necessarily a bad thing, but you have to still be aware of what the signals are, and then to try and answer any questions you have. So does that sound like a good program for?
Yeah.
All right. And if at any point you want to stop me to ask questions or have a little bit more clarification, please do. So I'm going to start with a little introduction to the history. When you consider how important architecturally, liturgically, and orally bells are in the life of the church for the past 1,500 years at least, it really surprises me how frequently you find musicians and pastors who are, according to canon law, the persons in charge of the ringing of bells, completely clueless about what they have in their tower. The University of Michigan, incidentally, is the oldest school in the nation for the study of campanology, which is the science of the acoustics of bells, how they're made, and also the traditions associated with bell ringing. It's the oldest in North America and second oldest in the world. We were founded in 1936. And to be associated with that institution is a great honor, as it is also, I should mention in passing, to be invited to attend and present to you here at this convention. This is a remarkable feat that the local community has put on. And I think how many extraordinary form masses do we have now? 17? 11 locally, and that's a great credit to this to the efforts of Alex and the many people who work here. And bell ringing has been coming along slowly but surely with that. I've been gently nudging Alex every time we talk about bells. The bells in St. Albertus Church were recently got to be ringing. You'll hear those later this afternoon. And it's because of the fact that you'll be hearing real bells that I've foregone including any recordings for you, because I think it's a little bit more interesting to take the course of actually experiencing the bell. What is a bell? A bell is a bronze object, usually. It is like a gong, except that it has a dropped center. So usually in the Western tradition, these are radially symmetric. You know, it's a perfectly axially symmetrical object. Bells, it can be assumed that there was fundamentally no break with the ancient world with regard to the use and function of bells in daily life until modern times. The Romans used handbells to announce that the public baths were ready, and a vast amount of archaeological evidence exists to support the theory that bells were known across the ancient world in almost every culture from Egypt, China, and the Americas upwards of 47 centuries ago. In Roman society, house bells and doorbells were a common feature. As a point of reference from the technical perspective, the largest surviving bell from the pre-Christian period is an external home bell found at Augst in Switzerland in 1946. It has a rim diameter of 16.7 centimeters. Now, this is important because one of the things that you're going to find to be a common thread with bells in the church, as with, for example, organs, which I'm also associated with, is there's a direct link to technology. We don't really understand all of the details about how bells and organs survived, but it has something to do with the fact that the Western Roman Empire collapsed. And when that happened, the technicians who were capable of building art objects, all that sort of collapsed with the empire. And we know that bell founding and organ building moved to Byzantium. And the most important advances in technology in that early period were all happening in Byzantium. And the instruments kept reappearing in the West because they were gifts from the Byzantine emperors, generally to the Pope or to royalty in the West. And it was that constant infusion of technology and the constant advancement of the technology in bell casting, bronze casting, which allowed the bells to grow and increase in size over time. And it's this increase, this dramatic expansion in technology, which causes the bell itself to change structure and evolve from these very simple little hand bells, which of course the original Sanctus bells were, into something which by the 5th century is larger, where we hear the Bishop of Nola in the Campana region of Italy. I don't know if any of that sounds familiar. Campana, campanile, campanology. Makes the first mention in the West of a bell, or what we think was a bell. He says he uses the Latin word signum, and he says that the signum was placed at the top of a church. Now, since this is the era before LED spotlights or air horns, we can reasonably assume it probably was a bell placed at the top of the church to call people to prayer. We think probably bells were not in use previous to 313 and the Edict of Milan, which legalized Christianity, because, of course, before that, Christianity was a bit of an underground movement. So sometime 4th, 5th century, probably certainly the 5th century, we have the first evidence of bells being used in the church. Externally. Now, internally, of course, previous to the Council of Trent with the rood screen, the function of the bell was very practical. It would let anyone outside of the choir know what was going on just by the nature of the signal that we're all familiar with in our churches, the approach of the consecration at Mass, just by virtue of listening to the bell through the acoustic of the church. So it was a very important oral signal. Interestingly, on that signal, by the way, all five of our churches today have an interesting architectural feature which derives directly from the evolution of the Gothic and Romanesque in Europe. You'll notice at the crossing there is a tower. And in all five of our churches, none of those towers contain bells, but originally in the larger, especially cathedral churches, there was a bell there that was rung at the Sanctus and for the consecration as well. So you'd have an internal signal and an external signal. The way we handle this now in the Detroit area is we generally give the external signal on the bells in the large tower, since those are the only bells that we have to work with. But it is interesting to note that architecturally, a special place was reserved for the Sanctus bell. It's called the Sanctus Tower. Talking a little bit about these bell profiles, you see, what's going on here, you have a very early example of a bell profile in the West. Let's say what we have here is probably 8th century. This is the High Middle Ages. And then here we finally arrive at the Renaissance. What happens, basically, you have to remember that these profiles or outlines of the bell wall do not relate to the size. So as we become closer to the modern age, the casting technology improves. The bell you're able to cast a much larger casting. Why would you want a larger casting? Well, why have one bell when you can have seven? So, but there's a couple of things to notice. And the terminology I'm going to use here, by the way, is also indicative of something. Bells, of course, all have names. They're considered sacramentals. In fact, you'll see some pictures of a baptism or a blessing of bells. There's a wonderful ceremony associated with that in the extraordinary rite. But they also have shoulders. This is considered the shoulder of the bell. This is the lip. This is the head. You have a crown, which can sit on top of the head. And it's from the crown, usually, that the earliest bells were suspended. But you'll notice a couple of characteristics. First of all, the bells, as they grow later, tend to shorten. And also, they expand at the shoulder, so they become wider. And most importantly, this thickening, where the clapper strikes the bell, it's called the sound bow, that thickens increasingly over the centuries till you have a rather large chunk of metal. And the purpose of the sound bow is twofold. First of all, when the clapper strikes the sound bow, if you have a heavy enough clapper, of course, it'll just shatter the bell, because bells are an alloy of copper and tin, bronze. And the bell bronze is actually very fragile. It's a crystal structure. But if you don't have enough mass of metal there, you'll hear something akin to the sound of a flower pot. So the sound bow is there to provide that beautiful resonance. Bow, B-O-W. And I don't want to get overly burdened down with the nature of the evolution of casting technology. I've included a drawing here of the three significant periods of casting, because we work from left to right, from earlier to later. Essentially, what divides the early period of bell founding in the West from the middle period, the High Gothic, is the way that the molds were formed. In the early period, this is a drawing taken after Theophilus, the molds were formed horizontally. We're going to talk about a bell mold. Just keep that in mind when I move on to the next picture, which is how bells are formed. This is from Diderot's encyclopedia, Encyclopedia des Arts et Métiers, I think is the title. I can't remember the date. It's a beautiful drawing from the 18th century showing every aspect of how every known technology in France was executed. This represents really the Renaissance way of forming a bell. The techniques are all the same. You're essentially building a mold in three parts. This is a modified lost wax technique. So how many of you have heard of lost wax casting? Okay, here's the brief run through on how lost wax casting works. This will give you an idea of how much time and trouble is involved in producing a bell. You begin by forming a core at the very center. This is usually built up of bricks. It's covered with a special mud called loam, which is built up of clay and sand and the secret ingredient, horse manure. I can explain why that's secret, but and sand. I know my students can't believe it when I tell them, really? Horse manure? Really? Anyway, you form this core on the ground. You thoroughly dry it out. And on top of that, you add a second layer, which you can see being built up here. That second layer is called the false bell. It looks just like the real bell, but it is not the bell. Now, in the earliest periods, this was done completely with wax. It was a pure lost wax technique. As the bells grew bigger, this grew increasingly expensive. Wax and bronze, in general, all materials, were much more expensive the earlier you go back. Labor was cheap. Materials were expensive. Now materials are cheap and labor is expensive. That's the general progress through the Industrial Revolution. This is a pre-Industrial Revolution technique, though, so we're dealing with a modified lost wax technique. You build a bell on that core out of mud, and you make it look exactly like the real bell, and you cover the very top layer with wax. That wax can also be the ornamentations that if anyone has gone up to the tower to see their bell, you'll notice they're usually heavily ornamented. They take a lot of time and care and attention and detail to this ornament. The names of the bells are there, and there's usually beautiful tracery. That's all applied at this stage. And then lastly, you build up a third layer on this mud cake, which is always having a fire underneath it and drying. This is the cope. I don't need to explain to you all what a cope means. The cope comes down, cements the whole thing together. You build a fire under it. You melt the wax out, the wax that you put in your false bell. Separate the two, the inner and the outer mold. Peel away the false bell, because now you have a negative impression of the false bell on the inside of the cope. Put it back together, bury it in the ground. Start your furnace. Hopefully you don't catch your roof on fire. Run the bronze into the mold, and then ideally 8 hours later you have a bell. Now, I'm skipping over a lot of details, including the nature in which the Renaissance bell founders perfected the techniques that they had built on for 1,000 years. The techniques achieved in the 16th and 17th centuries before the Industrial Revolution, which brought us such lovely, here we actually have an engraving of a bell foundry. The Industrial Revolution, which caused, you know, speeding up the process, building metal copes and casings. Those techniques have never really been excelled. The bells sound superior to anything we have in modern times. A lot of kind of boring technical reasons for that, but basically it boils down to somebody who creates a bell it's their vision, musically and harmonically and even spiritually, which is a part of that object. It was often thought in medieval times that bells had souls, or something like a soul. They were always attributed with mysterious, with this ability to drive away the fires and floods and storms. And that's even mentioned in the traditional baptism of bells, asking God to, through the voice of the bell, to drive away all evil. Sure. There are various forms. There are essentially various forms of clay and sand. So by mixing those different elements, you get different consistencies that hang together. And it's interesting to note that bell founding was sort of a jealously guarded secret. There were only a few families in North France, actually northern Bassigny, that really had this knowledge, and it was passed down from generation to generation. Why? Well, if you could cast a bell, you could cast a cannon. If you could cast a cannon, you could, lay claim to your neighbor's province, country, The limits didn't really stop. Anyway, I just wanted to walk you through that really briefly because these things took a lot of time and trouble to make. The bell founders in that region would go out annually, traditionally on Ash Wednesday, to execute contracts which they had signed the previous year. They would go to the place in the churchyard, build the furnace from bricks, build the mold from bricks, invite the whole congregation to help with the casting of the bell. So casting of a bell was a major event for parish and involved most of the summer. And then the itinerant bell founders returned to their families to help with the harvest towards the end of the year. So this is a major and important occupation of this region of France. The two guys who came up with bell tuning were part of this tradition. I'm going to talk about them in just a second. So now we get to the nuts and bolts of what I need to give you technically. There's two types of bell ringing. There's civic bell ringing and there's ecclesiastical bell ringing. How do you tell if they're one or the other, really, basically? Well, a civic bell is a stationary bell. A liturgical bell is a swinging bell. Think Quasimodo. Now, this is a really important difference. Of course, there are only two exceptions in the Western Church when a bell is struck stationary. The Angelus, where it's traditionally tolled three times, and then nine times, or sometimes you can swing a bell. Or for funerals, a funeral toll. Notice that I don't say the six bells toll for Mass. The verb to ring is different than the verb to toll for a very good reason. To toll means to strike the bell stationary. And in the Western Church, again, only for the Angelus and only for funerals. There's been an increasing trend with companies that like to electrify, or as I like to say, electrocute bells, and I can think of a dozen churches just within 5 minutes away, that they literally screw the wheels. The bells are essentially, as you'll see, simple pendulums. Screw the wheels shut and put hammers on the side of the bell that go clang, 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 and they call this bell ringing for Mass. Well, not only is it destroying the bell, because usually the hammer's harder than the bronze, which is, as I said, fragile, but also when a bell is in motion, just think of when a train passes by and you hear a train from one end of, what you're hearing is the Doppler effect. And so when a bell is in motion, it too is subject to the Doppler effect. And assuming that you are stationary, which most of us are when we listen to bells, but sometimes not, not if you're on the altar crew and you have to hastily run to get things set up, but that's another story. When the bells are ringing, you are hearing the Doppler effect. That's what produces this thing that we call ding-dong. Now, I've been called the ding-dong many times, but you've never heard the technical explanation before you met me. And so what causes the beauty of church bells ringing when they swing is actually that Doppler effect. This is another technical reason for it, is that when a bell swings, when a bell swings, it's like a pendulum. It establishes its own rhythm, so back and forth. So when you have one or more swinging in sequence, they're all sort of swinging on their own very musical rhythm. The drawing I had up for you previous to this is how a carillon works. A carillon is a set of tuned tower bells, which basically you can play from a big keyboard. That's what I do at the University of Michigan. These are civic bells. Anytime you hear bells playing music, any sort of music, that's really civic bell ringing, even if it's playing religious music. And, oh, isn't that lovely? There's a reason why only six Catholic churches in the United States have carillons. And I would say that this confusion really actually exists only in the United States because of the confusion that Protestant churches have brought with having music playing from their towers. Now, I said music, and I didn't say bell ringing from their towers, because generally we have a bad infestation of speakers in this part of the country, and I'll talk to you more about that. But just so you understand the concept, a carillon is a set of tuned tower bells that plays music. And how that's accomplished, you can see that there's a drawing here where you have a key, you press down on the key, it moves a lever, and the bell clapper only travels about an inch. The reason for that is because if you have that much mass, if you move it an inch, you can control it very carefully, which you need to do when playing music. Now, if you have a bell that's in motion, it's establishing its own rhythm. It's a pendulum swinging back and forth, taking to mind a couple of things. First of all, when the bell's mouth is up, it's making sound while its mouth is pointing out the tower. Also, thank you to the basic laws of physics, force does equal mass times acceleration, the clapper travels the entire distance across the interior of the bell. So what am I saying? Clappers all are 4% of the weight of the bell, right? Well, if it has that much further to travel, the sound of the bell is going to be much louder. So the purpose of church bells in swinging is very practical. It's to send a very large amount of sound out as far as possible to call people to church. Now, of course, initially we would expect the most simple churches to have a single bell. Church law suggests that larger parish churches have 2 to 3 bells, and cathedrals are requested to have 5. Why have more than one bell? Well, the more bells you have, the more complete and complex can be the sort of signal you send. Now, this is all subject to regional variation, of course, but the signals that bells send are specific to the feasts. This is very logical. If you have somebody at the other end of the rope, you know, to think, well, if it's Pentecost today, so we're going to ring lots of bells and very heavy bells, as opposed to just simple daily mass where you wouldn't want to ring the full peal. This is one of the greatest dangers I see in American bell culture, if you can call it that, because most people don't even think about what language the bells, you know, when a bell rings, it's saying something. In the 19th century, that bell rang because there was somebody down inside the tower at the other end of the rope who was there because something was going on in the church. So that bell was sending a very specific message about why it was being rung. You could stand in any region, and I know that there's at least one church in this diocese in Wyandotte, Michigan, for instance, Dr. David Saunders is music director at Our Lady Mount Carmel in Wyandotte. When those bells ring, the rectory phone starts ringing off the hook because people want to know who died or why are the bells ringing when it's not, you know, when it's not mass time. And so those, in these neighborhoods, in these cultures, in these villages, in these cities, you could identify the church that was ringing their bells and the solemnity of the feast and probably the occasion. It's a great book by Dorothy Sayers called The Nine Tailors, if you ever get a chance to read it. Tailors, or tellers, as its perversion of the English. You could tell who died based on the way that the bells were rung. So when bells are automated, frequently we lose this, because if you go to 97% of the churches out in the Archdiocese of Detroit, and of course I have been there to try and figure out what the bells are or what they know, they just ring all the bells on Sunday, every Sunday. Hey, it's a weekday mass. Let's ring all the bells. So what is it saying? It's musical babble. I mean, and the other problem, of course, is if you have a great, you know, if you have a solemn feast and you ring all of your bells for 10, 15 seconds, you know, in the old days, they would start ringing bells, if you think about it, some frequently half an hour before the mass, and then at 1:45. Sometimes in mountain regions, even as early as 1 hour before the mass, half an hour before the mass, and then 15 minutes before the mass, usually for intervals of about 5 to 7 minutes. The reason for this, well, you've got horses. You have to hitch them up. I mean, we can't do this 30 seconds before mass. So what we see is this very interesting progression in modern culture for how the language that bells once spoke to how they've been sort of relegated to this automated, automatic function now. I'm not against automation. I just think that if you have it, you should use it intelligently and always with a sense to what the liturgy, liturgical requirements for the day are. So there's a hand up.
What were the three things that you could identify? Which church, the solemnity of the feast, and what was the third thing?
The church, the solemnity of the feast, and the occasion. Getting very forgetful. Okay, I'm going to just... there's a lot of technical content in this talk that I want to give you all an introduction to this. I don't want to overwhelm you with this. I will say one thing. In America, this is a good example of a European bell. I mentioned just a pendulum. A pendulum, of course, involves a fulcrum. This bell just simply rocks back and forth. I say it's a European bell because it's unlike what you'll see in a second, which is more typical of an American bell. But you see that at this fulcrum, you have a second fulcrum here for the clapper. This is called a flying clapper bell because as the bell swings, the clapper flies up to the other side of the bell. It produces really a wonderful sound, but has the disadvantage of producing a lot of horizontal and vertical thrust. Thrust is pushing. And interesting how medieval builders solved this. They simply built in their belfries these very tall wooden frames and stuck the bells at the top of the frame. And I've seen it. I mean, I've walked in 14th century bell frames before. And what the bells do is they simply push back and forth and left and right. And that translates down through the frame as an up and down motion. Well, if your tower weighs, 300 tons, it's not going to care very much whether or not you've got a frame at the bottom of the belfry rocking it back and forth. So that's how the medieval builders solved the problem of thrust. In the 19th century, really in around 1858, and I have in my notes exactly who it was, McShane, who invented this idea of a cranked headstock. If you all have bells, 97% to 99% of American bells are all hung this way. The fulcrum is fitted in a U-shaped yoke so that the top of the bell here, the shoulder, really balances with the lip. It swings gently very back and forth. Now, if you are a pastor, or if you know a pastor, you will find that you have traveling salesmen on your doorstep all the time. And there are certain companies, not very many now, but there are certain companies that are anxious to sell you all sorts of lovely bell ringing equipment. As I said, automation is not bad necessarily, so long as the bell remains swinging. However, the primary arguments for automation that I hear, your tower, it's lovely, it's so old, but those bells, they're swinging up there, they're going to make the tower fall down. Well, I'm sorry to tell you that a cranked headstock bell, as it's literally rocking back and forth on itself, is probably not going to produce more than about 100 pounds of thrust in any direction. A good windstorm is going to put more horizontal thrust on your tower. Just be warned, that's a sales pitch, nothing else. I'm telling you this because I see so many, many, many examples of poor automation. And it's a good business model. I mean, you sell somebody automation that is not well made and breaks down without maintenance after 10 years and come back and sell them something else. The original stuff can be restored. You can generally, all you have to do is lubricate bearings and it will hold up for hundreds and hundreds of years. This is a good picture of a bell being rung manually by a monk. This is an abbey out in Washington. And I chose this photo because you can see how simple the mechanism is. When you pull the rope, you are pulling on a pulley. The pulley simply causes the bell to rock back and forth. That's how church bells work. Nothing more complicated than that. Now, when we're talking about tuning bells, well, these two brothers from France that I mentioned, their name were Francis and Peter Hemany. You have to understand that the reason why carillons evolved, this area of civic bell ringing, is because previous to the 16th century, the concept of time telling, well, if the only organization who had enough money to have a timekeeping equipment was usually a city. I mean, pocket watches weighed, they would fit in the palm of your hand and weighed probably about 5 pounds, and they were really baubles for tables in the parlors of the nobility. So if you wanted to know what time it was, and you weren't listening to the liturgical hours, the concept of civic timekeeping as it evolved in these very wealthy cities in Northern Europe, that was all because the city owned a clock. And around about the 12th century, somebody came up with the idea of, well, we can make a bell strike the number of hours. Oh, isn't that nice? Well, what happens if you miscount the number of strikes because you weren't ready to listen to the bell? Oh, well, we'll just ring a little warning bell before that. Okay, now, here we go, psychology. So if my city has a warning bell before their lovely hour chime, and we're going to invest a lot of money in our clock, well, wouldn't it be nice to have two? Okay, 2 years will by. Well, they've got two bells. We should have at least four. And then, by the time you end up in the 14th, 15th century, you've got chimes of 15, 18, 20 bells. At that point, though, you've got a problem, and that is that the tuning on these bells hadn't really been figured out. Tuning is basically controlling the profile shape so that the overtones produce essentially a chord. Tuning is like a telescope. I don't know if you all can think in... I realize some of you aren't musicians, but if you think about a telescope, all the bells in sequence are sort of like the lenses. You have to make sure that all the overtones line up, because otherwise you're not going to see through the telescope. So until the Hemany brothers figured out through trial and error this relationship of the profile to the tuning, I always tell my students tuning previous to 1644 was sort of an accidental sport. You poured the bell and saw what came out of the mold, and hopefully it played something like music. But the point is that all that technology came about shifting over time, and the civic bells really evolved out of timekeeping equipment. So when you hear that the Westminster chimes, for example, that's a warning to you that the hour is going to strike. It's still the job of most city caroliers in Europe to have to reprogram that tune 6 or 8 times a year on the drums which play the music. It's just like a music box. I'm sure you all are familiar with the concept of a large cylinder with pins in it. Incidentally, it's the carillon in campanology which can claim the role as the first piece of machinery in Western civilization capable of holding pre-programmed information. The carillon drums in Europe in the 14th and 15th century are really the origin of what we now consider information technology. It just infuriates the music technology division at U of M when I say that, but it's true. This is an example of a motor, a poor orphaned motor, very much like the one which is in the Assumption Church in Windsor. This is the first types of automation. I'm just pointing this out to you to show you that these are very large machines, and basically they run. This is an electric motor which is given a signal, a left and right signal from a clutch here. And as it runs forwards and backwards, it rocks the bell forwards and backwards. These things are built like Sherman tanks. If you keep them lubricated, which your maintenance men at your church can do, very, very simple mechanics here, they should last for pretty much ever. Although my primary suggestion to you would be, if you are in doubt about what to do, return your bell to ringing by rope, because motors don't break as ropes are much less likely to break than motors. And also, there's somebody at the other end of the rope, which means when they're ringing the bell, they're there for a reason, and they're calling people. A bell is still a sacramental. Even if it's rung by a motor, it's still a sacramental. And it's still calling people to pray. That has never been invalidated. I included this just to show you, for example, what a more modern bell ringing automation piece of equipment looks like. You have your bell, as we've explained. There's just a motor here, sending it forwards and backwards, and a separate external hammer here. That's the toller to strike for funerals. Now we get to my very favorite section of the program. And I really can't resist the urge. I don't like doing lectures and reading because I think it just gets boring quickly. And I realize that for all of you, campanology may not necessarily be the most the first thing you would have chosen necessarily for a lecture, but I try and make it exciting. Liturgical law is very interesting because it suggests how and when bells should be rung. And more importantly, it has things to say about simulated bell instruments. Now, here we see a technician carefully installing this quality piece of equipment. How long do you all think that a set of speakers, you all pretty much know what, you know, speakers, a magnetic coil, a set of speakers in an open-air environment last? Okay, now this is the lovely controller for the speakers. I'm not naming any names, but you probably might recognize the logo. The problem with this is that you're basically buying a glorified CD player. And contrary to what these companies are going to tell you, well, first of all, this is not a sacramental. In fact, the church quite specifically in the Instruction on Sacred Music and Liturgy from 1958, Article 91, propagated by the Holy See, it is strictly forbidden to substitute any kind of machine or instrument which merely imitates or amplifies the sound of bells mechanically or automatically. Period. It is, as a very, there's a very funny Polish priest in the area who would say, it is forbidden! You have to pound on wood when you say that. So, I'm sorry, you all, this is right out. And part of this is because people thought, well, wouldn't it be nice if we could have a carillon playing, some sort of music before Mass. But here we go again, this mindset in American Protestant churches that a carillon is liturgical bell ringing. It's not. It's civic bell ringing. Even if it's playing Panis Angelicus, well, it's lovely. It's still civic bell ringing. I'm sorry to break it to you. So anyway, that was the word about automation. And the other thing that's very important, you should let people know this. This machine easily could cost $8,000 to $15,000. You can find yourself a cast bronze bell, at least one for that. In fact, there are redundant bells. We hear of churches closing all the time. There are organizations and people who are very interested in seeing these bells find loving homes. Please, please. For instance, the Bilby Bell here, the 1743 Bilby Bell in St. Charles Borromeo, that was a bell that was reclaimed via the Caltech Trust in England and was actually the first bell consultation job I ever had in the city of Detroit. So I really encourage you all, invest your money in something that will last 1,500 years and not 10. That is, of course, my editorial opinion, however. Finally, a note about the beautiful ceremonies of bell consecration. There's a reason why bells are to be consecrated by bishops. The ceremonial in the extraordinary form, which has now had an updated form in the Book of Blessings for Bishops, it's just beautiful. I won't go into detail about the rite. I don't want to take time away from questions, but there's a reason why such emphasis is placed on bells. Again, they're sacramentals. There's a purpose why the church invests its time in bells. They're the voice of the church from without, in the way that the music is the voice from within. And they call people. Don't forget that. So if you have bells or you know somebody who has them, I encourage you, pay attention to the traditions of what the voice of your tower is saying. Just like anything else, you can babble, so can your bells. That's important, and it requires educating people about why are we doing this? This is as much a part of education as the liturgy. Why are we doing this? It's a beautiful thing. It's an ancient thing. Very rarely, in my spare time at the University of Michigan, I'm also a museum director. I run the Stearns Collection of Musical Instruments, which is one of the oldest, largest collections of musical instruments in the world. Very rarely in our culture can you see, feel, hear, or touch anything which was exactly or almost exactly the way it was 1,000 years ago. That's one of the extraordinary things about the Roman liturgy, is that continuity with the past. Bells are a part of that. One final point. I want to read to you, in closing, a quote from an 18th century source. I read a lot of things about bell ringing. And he gives the 7 reasons why bells are rung in the church. To gather people to the sacred functions of the church, to signify and distinguish his festivals, to rouse the souls of the faithful to render devout thanks to the highest for benefits received, to implore divine help against the tempests of air and ferocity of spirits of hell, to decorate the solemn entry of princes and prelates, to increase the happiness and gaiety of the public processions in songs of praise to the Lord, and finally, to make fervid piety of the faithful in relation to the dead. That says it all. I couldn't have said it more eloquently myself. I hope you've enjoyed this little presentation. Thank you all.